The following is a spoiler cast for Ruiner, in which all aspects of the game will be covered. If you wish to keep your experience pure, please give it a listen after you finish playing the game. Enjoy! Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to True Route Radio, the podcast that covers games from the very beginning to their final end. Tonight, we'll be covering the 2017 top-down action game Ruiner. Developed by Raycon Games and published by Devolver Digital, joining me tonight are two puppies ready to be unchained, Slowbeef and Bella. How you guys doing?
Pretty good. How about you?
I'm doing okay. It's very warm right now.
I'm doing very well. I am.
What's the weather forecast for you, Slowbeef?
It's raining. It's raining Ruiner. Well, actually, it is really raining outside, and I tried to work that into a pun, but it didn't quite work out. Whatever.
We tried. A for effort.
What should I look at? Oh, the rain grinder is going off nearby. Ha ha! Video games.
I guess I didn't add... off to a great start.
Promising.
So I guess I didn't add this to the docket, but... So Slowbeef, you really wanted to talk about this game when I was looking for different games to... do discussions on.
So I'll tell you, yes, when I saw the trailer for this years back, I was just instantly in love. Like, this is just totally spoke to me. Cyberpunk is my jam, but this especially was just stylistic and cool, and like I it was one of those things when then I got the game and I didn't play it for a while because I didn't have a good enough PC to, and also I'm like, I'm gonna be disappointed. And I wasn't, you know, I have gripes, certainly, but, like, I was really pleasantly surprised that this lived up to my expectations. I really, really enjoyed it. So, yeah, I was like, let's talk Ruiner. I think more people need to know about Raycon Games. I think this is their first game, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, they're opposite of a swan song.
Because it came out in last September, I went to PAX and I demoed it, and it came out and no one talked about it, and then just disappeared into the ether.
And it's so good, I think, personally.
Yeah, what would you give it out of 5? I'd personally give it a 4.
I think 4 is a fair, because like I said, it's not a perfect game, but I really enjoyed it. Usually, too, a game like this banks a lot on style and then the substance alters, but I do think it's a fun game to play. Yeah, I think toward the end, maybe, and obviously we're not going to jump right into that, but toward the end, maybe it starts to falter a little bit in terms of the story, but it kept me intrigued. I was definitely really interested to see where it went, and it has, like, this whole database, which I have up right now, so there's, like, a big world that they kind of worked out in it that you get to see a slice of, and the game ends on a pseudo cliffhanger, so, you know, maybe we'll get some more of the world of Rengkok, you know, who knows? Mm-hmm.
It'd be nice to because there's a lot of unique assets in this world they created. It'd be nice to get some of that reused in something else. I felt that it lasted like the perfect length. It was 4 hours for me. And then if it lasted like another 2 hours, I would have probably fallen off a bit more.
Totally agreed on that. Definitely did not stay its welcome.
What score will you give it, Bella?
I'd give it around like a 2.5 or 3, somewhere around that ballpark.
Oh, right in the middle?
Right in the middle. Like, right down the middle. Cyberpunk is one of my favorite genres of science fiction, and I really do like twin-stick shooters, and I really like things with loud, thumping techno music that's aggressive, and this game has all of those. And something about it just didn't necessarily click, and I absolutely agree with what you're saying, that it's the perfect length, because even by the end of the 4-ish hours that I spent with it, I felt like all the levels were kind of blending together into sort of this homogenous collection of tubes and metal platforms. So
red ones.
Yeah, red ones. Yeah. And there's like occasionally there's like a bluish mist kind of. It's definitely not like a bad game at all. I definitely just sort of felt like it was a bit repetitious, and I felt like a lot of the narrative elements, which we'll get into when we talk about it in depth, have been played out before. But it's pretty all right for sure.
Sure. Definitely. I think it had a very unique characters design to it, too. It hits all, like, the sort of cyberpunk-y kind of notes. And what I mean that in the sort of, like, if you were trying to stylize things like that, you know, you have, like, your, you know, mechanized prosthetics and your, like, cybernetics and all, like, all the stuff you would imagine would be there, but in a cool way, You know, so it's like, I do like how it never went full body horror kind of stuff, but there are like definitely like bosses and characters in there that are like unnerving in a certain way, you know?
It seemed like getting augments is just a natural thing for everybody to do in that universe.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely, yeah. Yeah, but then there are some, you know, like AIs and characters that they do a good job of making them like sort of unsettling in a way and in kind of unique sort of way. A lot of times I find, especially video games too, they try to marry sort of like horror and sexuality in a way, which is almost like a go-to.
Yeah.
But they did that pretty well here where, you know, they like kind of merge like what would be an attractive figure into like something like a little more sinister, you know?
Yeah.
It's a tough thing to pull off, and I think they did it well.
Especially with, like, the, and we'll talk about this more, but the pod people that show up near the end, I think they look, their designs were really, really good.
Yeah, the angels.
The angels.
Yep. Yeah. Exactly.
All right. Yeah, so I guess we'll talk about the critical reception. This game has a pretty positive score, although I'm not going to harp on it too much because I don't know, like, their full experience, but, like, I've read, like, the IGN and Polygon reviews, and they seem like they make the game out to be, like, this really hard 10-hour thing, and I don't know.
Yeah.
How they got to that conclusion.
It's not an easy game at the start until you kind of get the vibe for it. It's like Hotline Miami with longer sections, maybe. Mm-hmm. Like, it's longer between checkpoints. But you do get health, and once you start to really get, like, dashing down, and especially as more abilities unlock and you start to, like, combine melee with things like that, you get the hang of it.
Like,
there's, like, one or...
Like, I never regularly moved. I always dashed whenever I got a chance.
Yeah.
Yeah, you have to really get into the flow of that.
Yeah, because I totally tried to do it, like, standard gunfighting at the start and was just getting my ass kicked constantly. And then once you get dashing down and dashing through people and doing combos and things like that, it opens up more, you know?
Yeah. When I initially played it, so I played it launch week for the first time, and there were two really big things that got in the way, which, A, the mouse and keyboard controls in this game. I mean, yeah, I know it's a twin-stick shooter, but Hotline Miami had pretty acceptable mouse and keyboard controls. The mouse and keyboard controls in this game are very bad. Like, there's a weird reticle system that kind of threw me off. It doesn't feel good. So when I played it with a 360 controller, I guess a one controller at this point, it felt better. And then,
yeah, I played it with a one controller too.
And then the launch version of this game actually turned me off from playing it until they patched it, which is what I want to say like a month or so after release. Like, the launch version of the game's difficulty was actually pretty fucking unforgiving, in my opinion. The hit detection felt really strange to me, and I wasn't always completely sure what I was dying to, and it felt off. And so when I played it after they, like, put a difficulty patch out, I played through it in normal, but it was definitely easier for me. So I think a lot of...
That probably explains it, then.
Yeah, so a lot of initial reviews criticized the difficulty, and in terms of, like, the base vanilla game that came out, I do agree with that for sure. But it had got better.
I guess a short story is when I played it at PAX West last year, I was in line between two people, and for some reason, there's no one, like, manning the station. So I was sitting there and watching them play for, like, a good, like, 45 minutes because they just kept playing and wouldn't quit. And it's like, lines of PAX get long, but at the same time, like, so I was used to it, but I didn't expect, you know, some kind of courtesy for them to just, like, quit after 15 minutes. Or I guess they were just really tenacious.
Yeah.
they seemed to enjoy that it, so.
It put you up against the first boss, if I remember, Nerve, PAX East. Am I getting that wrong?
For me, at PAX West, was
PAX
security
West,
guard guy.
Okay, yeah. When I played a demo at PAX East, and they put you up against Nerve, and who was, like, I think the first boss proper, because, like, the security guard's kind of, like, the prologue boss, if I remember. Nerve's really hard if you've never played the game at all, really.
Absolutely.
So, yeah, I was, like, sitting there behind some dude who's, like, there for, like, half an hour, like, all right, man, you know, like, let's, you know, come on, it's okay, let's cycle through.
Because, like, just pause the game and lower, it's fine, I'm not going to judge you. I just want to play.
Let's work together on this. We're a team, but, you know.
Regarding, like, I found it a lot more like a character action game with the whole ranking system where, you know, it's the whole platinum thing of you go into an area and you do that zone over and over and try to get a better score, except I found it really difficult to get S+ in a lot of situations because there's not a lot of times to build a combo.
Yeah.
You know what
I mean? I only got it once.
I got a couple of S plus ranks, cool. But it was is definitely that like enemies in that game, don't they feel like they die really, really quickly, so you don't get to keep capitalizing on more and more coming in to build your combo?
Yeah.
It's only against like the kamikaze guys that you get a chance to like get the combo meter power.
Yeah, those were the ones that got me like the highest combos, where I just like had my base gun and I just shot the dudes who were blowing up. Like that was the easiest mm-hmm. way to rack up points for me, for sure.
Oh, totally. Those are those mines that float at you and they speak Japanese, I think. Right? Is that what's happening? Yeah. Or different kamikaze people, I forget.
The ones that have, like, the big oil tank or the big tanks on their back.
Right, okay. Yeah. I'm thinking of the mines. Because you could get good combos off the mines.
You could.
Yeah, those two.
I love those mines.
Those mines are pretty fun. I like those. Yeah. Those are cute.
Yeah, and then since there's invulnerability when you're dashing, you just do it to the last second. It looks really cool. I also, like, is this slowdown, like, randomized, or is there... like key points where it happens, because it seems like when I don't choose to use slow down time, you do get slowed down every once in a while for some random reason.
I found that if you were holding right click to do the dash, if you didn't do the dash immediately, you got like a small like window of slowdown. So I was using mm-hmm. that a lot rather than the slowdown skill proper to kind of like just like mm. you, if you don't get it long at all, but it's a very nice way of like, if a bunch of people are shooting at you, say, go there, you know, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
And you can sort of plan things out a little bit, like not plan it out like it's a strategy game or something, but like just sort of like, okay, maybe if I go over there, I'll be in a better spot, and then I get killed and I have to do it again. But still.
Mm-hmm. And like, oh no, I noticed the weird thing that I noticed, this might have just been coincidence or whatever, is when an enemy was shooting at me and I picked up a gun, that almost always triggered a slowdown. So I wonder if that's like a specific thing too. I don't know.
Hmm. I wonder if there is like some sort of high level play strategy you can do around that, where you say like, I'll, you know, dash here, grab this gun so I can change direction mm-hmm. or you know, get a cooldown faster or something like that. I have to imagine that there is, but
yeah, I almost expected every time like there would be one of those like instant death like turrets or something, but I think those are mostly the only times I died in the game where, you know, you just go down a corner and here's the beeping and then you don't have enough time to react to using your shield or whatever.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah. Speaking of skills, like I mostly use the slowdown thing, especially on bosses, because I got to a point where I could turn on slowdown, all of the buffs were on, then I would just stand next to him and swipe him constantly and then kill him before the time stop thing was slow ended, because I kept regenerating all my resources.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what abilities you guys ended up using. I used a little bit of hacking too, but there wasn't too many chances to use it because enemies would die too quick.
Yeah. The ghost break, you mean, right? Where you make them fight for you and stuff? Yeah. I had the same issue, that the enemies were just kind of too easy to kill, so I didn't really even bother with it.
I kind of ended up just boosting all the like the passive like health and, you
that
know.
That is exactly what I did.
I do that in all my videos. Anything that's increased max HP, I'm like, yeah.
Yeah, go
I
for it.
I have all the skills. I have the skills up here. There's like energy shield, which is like, it puts up like that little force field in front of you, like a shield you can bash with it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I use that on some bosses. And what I do like is it's a game that lets you rebalance the skill tree whenever you want.
Yeah, at all times. It's the Diablo 3 method, which is really cool.
Yeah. There's Overload, which is pretty cool, where, like, what is it? You uses up energy, but everything is, like, you're stronger, faster, etc.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, Kinetic Barrier was a smart one. That's, like, a permanent shield you can just place in the environment.
Yeah, I didn't use that one, huh? Like, yeah,
so there were a couple of bosses where it really helped. Like, I can't think of his name. Maybe I pull up his character. But, like, there's one heavy-duty boss with, like, a grenade launcher. Or mini-boss.
The captain guy. Or
Yeah, exactly. He was a really good use case for Kinetic Barrier, because then it kind of renders the grenade launcher a little useless, or even hits him. Mm-hmm. You have to kind of time it. You have to reset it, because he'll move around the arena, too. But it's really... that was a really helpful one. Let's see. There were, now I'm looking at all like the enemies and stuff too here. Cause, anyway, so yeah, there was that ghost break, obviously. And then like there's converters, which like you can say turn energy to health, which I use, but then they're like turn health into energy, which I'm like, I'm not good enough for that.
Oh, you can use both abilities at the same time. It's just a toggle basically.
Yeah, yeah. So you could, like, you can drain your own health to give yourself more energy to do, like, really cool stuff. But, like, I'm too skittish about that, where it's, like, losing life, no thanks.
Yeah,
you know?
Same.
But, yeah. Yeah, there's, like, a lot of really cool skills in the game, really, though. Like, yeah, dash, obviously, and then Yeah, and then there's all this passive stuff, like resource optimizer and like use of weapons and things like that.
Oh yeah, so there's definitely something. It's like, even though I was not particularly hot on the game at like overall, there was enough there that I could see myself going back and trying to play it through differently with different abilities and like trying to get better scores. Like, there's enough variety there to keep me coming back to it if I'm like bored someday, you know.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
In fact, I'm like talking about it now, I almost kind of want to.
Yeah.
Well, actually, immediately after being it, you unlock speedrun mode. So I happen to do that. And so the fastest times are 40 minutes. I managed to beat the game in an hour and 30. So I think there's a big difference between me and what they can pull off. But yeah, it's a lot quicker the second time around.
No, totally. Yeah. And looking at it too, there's like coins to find and they have like cats, which I forget what that is. I'm assuming I have my status is not yet started on any of them because there's three major levels, right? Yeah.
Yeah. And we can talk about so there's side quests where you talk to this hacker lady and she says, find all the cats in the city map. And
yeah,
you get to unlock some kind of resource area, the hidden area. And when you go to the real areas, I skipped one by accident. So I never, but like I got all the things in Cat Creep's Nest and things in hell. Like it's not anything substantial you're missing. It's just like a zone that gives you like better weapons that, you know, deplete really quickly anyway. Speaking of weapons, I mostly just use melee the whole time. And then maybe I'll take the shotguns for, you know, the bosses that prefer that.
The shotguns were really so cool.
The little, the fidget spinner shooting razor thing was pretty cool.
Yeah, I like that too.
Yeah.
So the ice beam, well, I did not like at all.
Nah.
I mean,
it took forever to boot up and stuff like that.
The ice beam had a problem of like, okay, I just froze you, but I have this sword that has a limited amount of hits on it, so I don't want to waste one of those hits to shatter you. Mm. So I guess I'll just shoot you with more ice. It kind of broke the flow up a little bit.
Yeah. I liked the beam weapons fairly generally. I feel like Raijin was a cool one. That was the electric beam weapon, if I remember.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. I like that one a lot. You're right. The ice beam I didn't really care for. And the flamethrower I thought was a little disappointing, too, unless I'm misremembering it. But
it was useful only like basically in the angels areas where you're just blasting all the zombies. But otherwise,
That's right.
They give you like a million of them for that part.
Yeah.
Yeah. You have the runer, the titular weapon, I guess, which is like that standard gun when you run out of everything. Right.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I have the whole list here. Yep, Raijin is the electric one. Oh, the arc gun I forgot about. I think I like that one. That's another electric gun, actually, though. Yeah.
Oh, it's the one that like arcs all the energy between a bunch of enemies once, right?
That's the one, yep.
That was cool. Yeah. I really liked that one a lot.
Unfortunately, with that one, you're mostly fighting like two or three enemies at once, so it doesn't get too much play, except for like, you know, the area.
Mm-hmm.
I did notice, like, and we'll talk about this when we talk about this actual level, but, like, a lot of the best weapons and the weapons I had the most fun with were reserved for, like, that final onslaught of enemies, and it was like, why wasn't I able to use these for most of the game? And I guess the answer is if I had done more side stuff, I could have probably had easier access to those, but it was still kind of, like, a bummer, I guess.
You do get them to pop out of the grinders, which, if people listening haven't played the game, they're basically, after you finish the zone, you can hit this thing to make it pick up all the items you didn't use, and it converts that to experience and a better weapon.
Yeah.
Which is, I think that's really cool, because otherwise I would have felt guilty for like not using things throughout the stage.
Yeah, absolutely.
Put something to use for something.
It was a novel system, for sure.
It was really weird, too, because it had like this like loot box element of like everything had like ranking, so there's also gold and purple for some reason. I know it gives that's it like obviously more ammo, but it was just a little funny.
They also have sonic guns, which are kind of neat. They were sort of like a wide area of effect sort of. There are like a lot of neat weapons in the game, I feel like, you know.
All of them feel a niche.
Yeah. There was like and also even the melee weapons, you could get like high frequency blades, metal pipes, obviously. A mace, which they kept giving you. It was like a fiery mace.
Fire starter,
That's it, yeah.
Yeah.
And then an armor breaker, which was this big ass hammer that like.
That was cool.
Yeah, I love that one. It's my favorite one to use.
I felt after you beat Nerve, that upgraded sword you got made melee really, really easy because everyone had a bleed effect after that point. Mm-hmm. So enemies like you'd hit enemy once, you'd dash away, and then they would die off screen while you're fighting someone else.
Yeah.
You couldn't even do like the finisher, yeah.
I tried to stay with guns for a lot of it, but then I switched to melee and I was trying to stay with guns because I had like oh, what's his name? Real Soviet Bear. Like a speedrunner come in and tell me like, oh, just use melee. It's great. But I'm like, nah, I just want to stay and use guns and kind of be cool and stuff like that. So,
yeah. I actually really enjoyed like the way I mainly used guns in this game. And I kind of was, I was hooked on the system because most twin stick shooters, I feel, yeah, you have your base weapon. Like, I don't know, Smash TV or whatever, or Hotline Miami. Like you have a base weapon that's pretty okay. And it's your, like your standby, and then you can pick up weapons that are like that have a generous amount of ammo on them, so you can use them for a few minutes. And this, like the ammo in each gun was super limited, and I actually found that to be really, really novel in the sense that it made me not just like spray and pray. It really made me focus on being accurate, mm-hmm. and I actually really appreciated that. That was cool. I don't see that very much in this genre.
No, totally. Totally agreed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, except for maybe the bosses. Those are a little spongy, but
yeah, for sure.
Let's talk about instant kills for a second, because I guess they borrowed this directly from Doom, and I think it was a really cool feature. I also like the fact that it was pretty generous with when you can do, because you basically can enter it mid animation for anything else, and you would immediately just do an instant kill right away. Mm-hmm. And since it slowed down time for a second, it gave you a chance to like absorb everything, like pay attention to everything going on around you before you jump to the next guy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, those are really cool. Like, I'm glad you picked up on the Doom vibes too, because I definitely got that as well. I would have liked a few different animations for it, but it felt really good. And like, I definitely did like the decapitations where like enemies' heads would just fly off the screen. That felt really cool.
I like the kick the most when he just kicks them really hard and their head goes flying off.
That's pretty dope.
There's definitely there's actually an enemy in the game called Donvius. He's a boss, like part of the headhunt. I'll see if I can get a picture of him here. But he actually has like a shirt that's like a very clear reference to Doom.
Yeah, Brutal like, Mum. I think it's his on it.
That's the one. Yeah.
Huh.
Yeah. Yep.
And he's the first. I like the bosses how they introduce like new weapons for you to use by using them themselves. So he was using the razor shooter thing.
But yeah, the instant kills felt good, and I think the whole idea of like trying to combat the weapon that you're about to take from somebody is like, I mean, obviously that's not a new idea, but it felt particularly good here, especially with the momentum this game has.
Totally. Mm-hmm.
I felt it slowed down a little bit when you started fighting like the guys with like one or two pips of armor when they're glowing red, and then you have to hit them like a amount of times before they can be vulnerable, but otherwise it was a pretty fun bloodbath. I kind of wish there was more enemies on screen at once in some cases too, so I can, you know, capitalize on combos more.
Right.
There were, I don't know how I felt about the vampire enemies, the robots that, like, kind of come in and they, like, drain your health as long as they're on. Or they, like, there's, like, a timer.
Those suck.
Yeah.
Yeah. Luckily, you can get rid of them pretty quickly with just, like, two melee swings. But, yeah, it's kind of.
Yeah.
I appreciate them because it's a different kind of. Because for the most part, you just find guys that dash around constantly and throw things at you.
Sure.
So absolutely. They added a little mix of, like, change your priorities of targeting something else, or else you'll get your ass kicked.
Mm-hmm.
And you mentioned the enemies dashing around, and there is an enemy type that I thought was really cool in this, which was like eventually you end up fighting those syndicate dudes who, or triad dudes, and they just like blip around the room. Yeah. And it's something that I really, really appreciate for this genre because it constantly kept me spinning in different directions and kept me on my toes instead of just settling into a familiar rhythm. And I really liked that. It kept things kind
of
fresh.
Because a lot of other games like this, you're usually walking around the room in concentric circles, shooting or shooting away from you. And this one manages to break that by having you leap everywhere, you know, utilize explosions, hide behind box high walls and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, and the explosions, like the barrels that shot in a direction that they shot towards you, and you had to like basically kind of get enemies in your path and then shoot the barrels into them. Like that was really cool. I loved that.
No, totally.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So I guess we can start running down the game, unless I'm missing anything, or unless you guys have anything
mini games
else you
want to add. And I don't know why they were there.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, so I added an element here. So here's a problem I have with owning, like, every single major console for, like, the last decade. Yeah. I get confused so easy over X and Y all the time. And it kind of sucks, too, because, like, the Xbox controller is, like, the most ubiquitous thing, so you're just, like, oops, I screwed this. Luckily, there's, like, no penalty for retrying, but...
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, it's gone away.
I mean, and this game has a lot of those things of, like, here's a system that's here, or, like... Here's a way to open a door that requires holding A, or here's a holding A to complete the sequence of like, it's a system that, like, for as short as this game is, just kind of feels like padding, and I don't know why it's really even there. It didn't, like, the hacking and the riding the light speed bike thing that you end up doing, those just kind of didn't really add to a mood, and it just kind of felt like filler.
The
light
speed bikes, especially, I felt like it was, it was fine the first time, but you do it like four or five times, and I don't know why.
Yeah.
Or like the 20 times you're watching the Traffic King animation where you're shocking him to get him to do stuff for you.
Yeah, like, why is that even a, like, I was able to go through doors in the earlier levels without holding A, and now I have to hold A to go everywhere.
Yeah,
and
we're jumping a little ahead, but speaking about him, I felt really sad for him.
Traffic King is one of my gripes with the game's story. It's a character, he's a boss, I think, right? And then, and when you beat him, you're given his head floating around with you, and you're allowed to, like, shock him. And the game, I think, refers to torture or punish, I forget. But you don't really know much about trafficking, so I don't know.
He seemed like middle management for the most part, and he was just doing his job, and then he gets punished by everybody for it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like, I guess from his name, I'm supposed to believe he's involved in human trafficking or something somehow. But by that point in the game, they're like giving me like an option, like, you get to torture him now. But I'm like, but who is he? Like, why would I want to? Like, what's my motivation for hating this guy enough? You know, that kind of. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'm assuming they hope with the Kojima-ass name they gave him that you just assume what he is.
Right.
But yeah, I absolutely agree.
Yeah, like that, I just feel like there could have been a little something more to him.
100%.
Like, when you go back to the city with him, you get to talk to everyone, and everyone reacts to him, but he's just being a dick the whole time, where he just doesn't want to be there, and he's just complaining. He's like a little kid that, you know, taking you on a trip with you.
Yeah, like, I'm actually reading, and I'm reading his database entry now under characters, and there really just isn't anything here. Like, it's just, like, he's Heaven's second in command, answers only to the boss, controls Hanza compound. Like, okay. You know?
I mean, and I guess, I assume by control Hanza compound, that means he gets people in those pods, and that's why he's called trafficking, because he traffics them into the pods, the virtuality thing, which we'll talk about.
If there was just a scene where he was torturing you for information, like giving you electric shocks and stuff, then when you get to do it to him, it's at least like, okay, now I see why I'm doing that. But it feels like there's just a missing part of the story that they never got to do or add.
Absolutely.
Yeah, like when you're talking to the mechanic guy, he said, I could have taken away his free will, but I decided not to, just to be funny about it.
Yeah, it's like, so what is everyone talking about? You know, like, why is this guy such a dick? Why won't you just tell me, you know? But
I think there's a difference, which I guess you'll mention when we talk about the plot a little bit, is like, there's a difference between having a narrative that's obfuscated and it does a really good job of it, like David Lynch films, I guess, for example. And then there are points in this game and other pieces of cyberpunk media where it's kind of like, you're obfuscating these backstories and this lore so much that I'm kind of not sure what I'm supposed to be feeling about anyone involved in the main cast, you know? And I think
we're
going to
save
kinda
it for a sequel.
probably.
It's an interesting dilemma, I guess, with sci-fi too. Do you ever see there's like a joke sort of novel that's like what a sci-fi novel would be like if it were written in present day? And it's like, I went onto a plane. An airplane is a device that exists that lets me fly from one place to another. And it's like, but it's like, it's true, right? That like in sci-fi, you kind of need someone or something to sort of explain this new world to you, the contemporary reader. Meaning that, like, when you kind of leave these things alone, like, it's sort of like, well, wait, are they being obtuse, or did I miss something, or what's going on here?
Well, that's why Repo Man works, because everything's fucking weirded out in his future.
Absolutely.
So, starting from the beginning, and this is what they had a demo for, you're being mind-controlled by this hacker kid wizard guy, and he wants you to go kill the boss of Heaven, which there's a lot of on-the-nose metaphors in this game, but you're going through this whole thing, you're killing a whole bunch of guys that you don't know why, you're just being mind controlled to do it, and then he activates at the end this kind of timer thing, which I saw more of, which is like, you have 40 seconds to kill this guy, otherwise you'll die too. And
but one of the game's cooler set pieces is he's like forcing you to kill boss, basically, and he keeps like kind of appearing on screen. And then when you get to the boss of the level, Chief Wadayama, the security guard, there's this really cool thing he does where he says, like, How about I give you a time limit? If you run out of time, you'll just die. And it starts at a minute, but then the timer just drains down to 15 seconds, which was, a really cool, oh, shit, this game's not fucking around kind of moment. I was so into that.
I really like the helmet system too, where just a cool guy with just stuff appearing on his helmet at all given any given time.
It's like this LED display, and I wish there was more to it, because I love it, but there's only 5 or 6 things that it says, and some of it's it'll say kill you in red text that's scrolling, it looks awesome,
and that's cool as hell.
And then it'll say drink it, which I'm like, yeah, okay, and then we were never friends, and I'm like, that's a little.
Yeah, and then it gets a little creepy too when it shows a real person's lips on
there. Yeah, that's a good smiling. One. Yeah. But it's we were never friends, and then it was I'm not inviting you to my birthday party, and just stuff that's kill you.
And then whenever you're given dialogue options too, I always went for either crack knuckles or shrug.
I love, me too.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, there's
I just nodded.
Yeah, that's all your dialogue options are great. There's crack knuckles. Yeah, it was awesome. I love that.
Yeah.
God, this game just oozes style.
Yeah, the character designs in particular in this game, I think, were probably my favorite part of it. You have the hacker, you have the person who's guiding you the whole time, who we'll talk about a little bit. She looks like a rejected Gorillaz character, and that's awesome. She looks like D.Va. Holy shit!
Scored on that one. Yeah,
Even Chief Wadayama, he's the first boss. You don't really need any big thing around him, but he looks great. He's in this suit, sort of, but it's kind of he has this face that you can kind of see. It's there's lines in it that are unnatural. So he's part machine in some way you can't quite tell.
Yeah, very Deus Ex kind of, or Ghost in a Shell kind of thing, where they just, and for some reason. For some reason in the future, people, when they get cybernetics, they have to embed weird lines and shit all over their faces.
And he's smoking, and he says, I think his, dialogue is, on the order of just, look, either you'll kill me or I'll kill you. That's just business. And, just for this one, prologue boss that you never see or hear about again, he has, a good personality. I want to know more about Chief Wadayama. I don't want a prequel with him. But I want, you know what I mean?
Absolutely.
Yeah. So you do beat him, you do make your time limit, and then
you try to put your arm in a door and it blows off.
Yeah.
Okay, so you...
Go ahead. No, please.
Oh, you okay. Okay. I was hoping to be lazy and have you tell us.
Oh, I can do it. Yeah, sure.
Go ahead.
All right, so now you'll have to correct everything I do wrong here. Okay, no. Your arm blows up, and it turns out there's a hacker who is trying to kind of save you from this wizard guy. And her name is, she's referred to as her. She seems like a teenage girl, a young woman kind of girl. I can't, sort of indeterminate age, I guess. But, and she has basically told you that this guy wizard hacked your brain and is trying to make you kill the boss. So, she is going to help you get revenge on wizard. And her motives are pretty unclear at the moment, but, we'll take what we can get. She brings you, if I remember, you wake up then in this guy Mechanix's place, and he's this old man who's fixing you. He gives you a new biomechanical arm, I think, or a mechanical one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he's always smoking.
Yep. And you wake up, he's always smoking. He's always kind of looking over you. And yeah, we wake up in the world of Rengkok, which is the cyberpunk city du jour of Runer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very, very Asian.
Mm-hmm. And as we understand it,
y'all see Blade Runner?
Yeah, yeah. It's like Neo Kobe City, Rengkok, all those video game cyberpunk places. But it's very busy, Rengkok. And I think we have to talk to a cop named Rykon who points us in the direction of the creeps, who are some cyberpunk gang of misfits, and Wizard the hacker has basically paid them to guard him. So we're to get our revenge, we have to go to the creep's hideout, kill a bunch of them, and then go after Wizard for hacking into our brain.
If you think about now, the creep's hideout represents a third of the game, but you're just doing a really mundane thing where you're just going in there, finding information, and then getting a really cool sword, and then defeating Wizard.
Yeah.
So I'm looking at the design for her now, and it's kind of funny. She has all these, those guys at cons that always collect all the pins, and they're really like,
yep,
yeah, yeah,
pin fanatics. Like, you got this pin? Can I trade you for it? And all this.
Yes.
I know she has a berserk. She has a berserk one on her, and also a couple pills from Acura.
I got a Russian vibe off her too, which I think could be from the voice actress, possibly. I mean, I don't mean that she's, but I mean, I feel like I picked up an accent from her that was kind of Eastern European whenever she spoke to you. Or is that just,
yeah, sometimes when she would say, like, find him Buppy or find him Puppy, it sounded like she was saying find him Buppy, and that just made me laugh every single time.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then, she even like Diva, she's using all the emoticons and shit like that constantly.
I really liked that a lot. That was really a nice touch.
Yeah, absolutely. And I like to, basically at the end of every round you fight, you get a grade, you know, like we mentioned before, like S rank and everything, but, and you'll get some graphic of her that she's either disappointed or happy with you. But, like, not in any sort of... You could picture, like, most games doing that in, like, kind of a sexualized sort of way. Like, yay, I'm jumping up. But it's, like, totally cool here. Like, he's totally, like, your pal. Just like, yeah, I'm rooting for you. Still don't know why I'm doing this, but I'm rooting for you. I'm on your side. Or, you know, you could have killed those guys faster. Come on, you know? It's like, I don't know. I just appreciate it because it was really different than what you would have, like, ordinarily expected.
Yeah, I mean, I think especially for the genre, you know, you... Like, this genre obviously had its cybernetic sex workers. It had all of that stuff in it. But I think an issue I have with a lot of cyberpunk is that it relies on the same old, like, sexual tropes that just feel tired and played out at this point. And yes. I think that Ruiner was actually pretty restrained with that. And I think that's really commendable.
Totally. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they were really good about, like, giving you stuff that maybe if you'd seen something like it, it at least, like, had its own kind of twist on it or, you know... It really felt like it owned what it was trying to do, if that makes sense.
Yeah, 100%.
Totally.
Yeah. Getting back to Berserk for a second, I really like they included two songs from Suzumu Hirasawa, who worked on all the Berserk adaptations, and also he did some Satoshi Kon stuff like Paprika. So
yeah,
when
his Paprika score is amazing.
So when the vocals came in, I said, this sounds familiar, and then when it got to credits and I actually saw his name, I freaked out a little bit.
Yeah.
Granted, the songs were Wario ones he made back in the 90s, but it's still cool that they, you know, they wanted to get that aesthetic and they nailed it.
Oh, really? I didn't know that they were, like, old tracks. That's
yeah,
funny.
Yeah, they didn't get them to make new ones or anything. Well, I think the dude's, okay, like,
I was
60
wondering about
now,
that.
So.
Okay. Yeah, I like her. I know we're dwelling on her design a lot, but I also just really like that her headphones say bad all over. Like, I want those headphones. Like, I want her headphones and her jacket and her everything.
So many of these characters are just wonderful, like, just to look at, you know?
100%.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
Like the weird weird fortune teller with, like, this huge VR headset on.
Oh, yeah, Shingora.
Yeah, it reminded me a lot of Valhalla, if you guys have played that, in terms of, like, you have this cool cyberpunk future, and all of the characters are very interesting to look at. Like, and it's, like, I'm thankful that this game had, like, a visual novel-esque element of, like, scroll through dialogue and talk to people's character portraits, because I got to take in the art, and that was, like, one of my favorite parts of the game, honestly.
Totally.
Yeah.
Totally agreed.
Like, I'll post a picture about it right now, but even, like, this this random stockbroker guy, he has just this weird implant over his nose and mouth.
Oh, yeah, that guy.
Oh,
yeah.
Yeah.
Opportunist.
Did you ever find out what was up with the hag? Because it just seemed like some old hobo that was carrying trash bags everywhere.
No.
I didn't. No, I just kind of, like, was like, this is some dialogue, this is some flavor, and then I moved on. Which was my relationship with most of the side content in this game, admittedly.
It just, a lot of it seemed like busy work. Since the game was for the most part linear, you would complete all their quests, side quests anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So there wasn't like some kind of like Wolfenstein thing where you had to do certain objectives in each map, like kill like certain guys or do it in a certain way. No, you just had to happen to walk over the coins or the area that you needed to get to.
Right.
And
right.
It just gave you experience. It didn't give you like any hidden weapon or unlockable. At least that.
And there wasn't anything, like, narratively substantial in most of the side content from the little that I did, like, which it kind of makes or breaks these kind of games for me. Like, Deus Ex is a really good, has a good example of, I think, Deus Ex is, of the side content often eclipses the main narrative of those games for me in terms of, like, the world building that's accomplished in them. And I don't think this game really did that at all.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it was busy work. I think you hit the nail on the head with that one.
Yeah. But,
go ahead.
I was just gonna say, so yeah, in the Creeps level, right, you end up killing Nerve, who's their boss. And now, once you've done that, the creeps now love you. They're like, you're one of us. You're totally great. And you get a very...
You feel like a picture with them on it.
Yeah, exactly. And, but you get a very satisfying scene where you kind of walk down Wizard, who's like, you know, get away from me, and you get to kill him for hacking your brain and sort of taking control of you, etc. Then you get your next quest, which is basically her is telling you now, let's go save your brother. Which, mm-hmm. this is where the plot starts to lose me a little, because there was no mention of a brother or anything. So it just felt kind of... I feel like that could have been handled a little better. But, like, not so bad. I was like, all right, I'll go with you on this. But, what brother? You know? And
yeah, but, like, being a cyberpunk game, it just immediately felt like, okay, there's going to be some kind of twist about this, so I don't trust sure. this situation from the beginning.
Oh, yeah, and definitely. And even, like, the whole notion that she's telling you what to do is odd in the first place. Like, no one ever explains, like, why she's really helping. Or she never really explains. And you're just kind
of... Yeah, unfortunately, we've all consumed so much of this kind of media over the last couple decades that, you know, it just felt like there's going to be a twist somewhere, and I'm just readying myself for it.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Getting back to Nerve for a second, do you feel like he should have been like kind of like a rival character that you'd fight multiple times?
So the way they built him up, I thought he was going to be like your rival, like your Shao to your Sonic or something like that, that you would fight over and over until the end of the game where you finally have one big showdown. But instead, it's just one fight where you get his weapon.
Yeah.
He's got the mask.
Yeah, and like you get his sword, and that's supposed to feel substantial, but it doesn't, because like
it feels substantial because it's so strong.
Right. That yeah, like in a like gameplay sense, sure, but like I think like we're supposed to have this moment where it's like, I have your weapon now. It's like, okay, but I've seen you a few times and now you're just dead, so I don't really understand the narrative ramifications of this, but cool, I guess. Free sword.
I think I think that would have been a great addition, having Nerve be a persistent, like, a rival or something. Because he's even listed in the database characters, like with Wizard, Mechanics, her, you know?
Yeah. He has his own entry.
Yeah. Unlike, I mean, and all the other bosses are under the different... So yeah, I really feel like that was a miss on their part or something. Maybe they couldn't quite pull together at the end, you know?
Hmm.
Yeah, I feel like there are a lot of concepts in this game that, like, have a lot more depth to them than we actually got to see, and there were, like, maybe budgetary constraints or time constraints that prevented them from getting fully capitalized on.
I totally agree.
I think from a scope, the game was, what, was it $20 on launch?
I think so.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's, like, the perfect price for it, because it was just this four-hour adventure that, from a first-time developer, that, like, fit perfectly. Yeah. But yeah, there is little aspects here and there that like kept it from being like memorable. Because a year from now, I'm not gonna remember anything about this game.
I'll have trouble with some like Nerve. I would have trouble. I'll remember the name because it's easy. But yeah, there's like looking at the database. I was even just like, oh, that's right. You know that person. You know that.
You know, like as someone who writes, like I can tell that a lot of love went into this game, and a lot of that lore is there somewhere in a notebook, and that notebook is probably 300 pages long. Like it's one of those things where you feel like you're scratching the surface of the depth that's present in this world, which does make me hope that we do maybe get to see more at some point. I would like to see this idea more fully capitalized on, you know, this world. I like to see more about the characters, etc.
Right. Like, in the database, there's things like the citizenship, which, you know, it's a part of the world, but doesn't play any major part of it, or even minor that I can think of. Like, Mechanics makes you a new one so you can interface with things, but nobody really knows who you are. But, like, okay, but thanks. And it's nice that it's there. It's nice that the person who wrote this had that idea in their head. But like you say, yeah, there's probably more to it in that person's head that didn't make it into the game. Or Third Children, which I don't think really comes into play unless I'm forgetting something.
You have to remind me what that is, because I don't even remember.
That's under Database World. A Third Children, so notice Rengkok has a strict two-child enforcement policy. If you have a third child, they're automatically drafted into public service.
Huh.
Gotcha.
Which I don't remember anything in the game where that comes into play at all. And like,
because it definitely doesn't.
Right. When I saw that entry just by chance in the database and I was like playing the game, and I'm like, I bet that's going to come back, that I'm a third child. But no, it doesn't at all. So I'm like, huh, okay, you know. It's like, it's suddenly, like, just talking about it now even, like, I must be forgetting something, right? It couldn't just not be referenced. And it's like, yeah, no, I guess not. All right.
Yeah, so anyway, you move on from this part from just hunting down bullies to basically infiltrating a compound and going past all these guards and stuff like that. So we run into the first encounter with Mother, which I didn't like this boss too much.
It was cool different the first time.
Did you all die instantly the first time because you didn't know you're supposed to slow down time? Yeah.
I ate shit a few times and I was like, oh yeah, blocking. I've barely done that in this game. I should probably do that.
I feel like Mother could have been a different fight or like one of those, you know, those like sections in video games where the boss is kind of hounding you for a while. Like you have to dodge that giant energy beam of hers or take cover for a while until you, I don't know, destroy some defenses somewhere else. Then you get the fight proper. That I feel like, yeah.
Because you do break off a little bit when you have to defeat like the limbs, but you do that so many times that it kind of gets bored.
Yeah. This could have been used some fine tuning for sure.
Yeah, and like the mother fight in particular is like you see it, if I recall correctly, I replayed the game like a few weeks ago just to get it fresh in my mind. Like you kind of do the mother fight under different names a few times throughout the game. Like you fight a mother two or three times, there's another fight that's basically the same thing except you don't have to go kill the limbs. Like it's a really cool first shock introduction of like, oh shit, I'm just getting messed up here. Yeah. And then you kind of know the gimmick the third or fourth time around, and it's not really nearly as exciting.
Yeah, it doesn't change. It's just like a DPS race of how much damage you can get before it shoots the beam again.
Yeah, absolutely. And then, like, it actually gets kind of easier in later forms of, like, oh, there's actually cover here that wasn't in the other levels, so this is actually way easier now. It's weird. It's a weird idea that, like, could have been fleshed out more.
You know what kills me, too? And I just double-checked this just to make sure I'm right. It says Mother Engine on the front of Mother, and then there's a kanji under it that actually means daughter, for the record. But,
huh.
I saw that, I'm like, is that daughter? And then I'm like, I better double check, because I'm going to look really stupid if that's not. But, it absolutely is. So, I don't know what they were trying to, underlying theme, they were trying to sneak past me there, Runer. But, you, sorry.
I like the Yoshi bots. They're just like,
those are fun.
Yeah, they are.
And then when they find out you're like responsible for all the chaos, they're like, "Oh, it's you." Okay.
Yeah, the Yoshi bots are fun. I thought something else would go on with them, but
Now they're just there working, just getting. No. Someone's gonna have to work.
You do run into Heavy Cyborg, which is my favorite enemy in the game, which are like the big.
Oh yeah.
I shouldn't say they're my favorite enemy, like in terms of gameplay per se. I mean, they're still. I think they were a fun fight from what I remember, but like, they're just very big and imposing, like robots, and
they have like the Wolverine claws, right?
Yeah,
and cool. Then they can shoot projectiles if you get too far away from them and stuff like that. They're basically built to counter you, I guess.
Like, once you see your first one, you're like, oh, shit, this is going to kill me. You know, like, but it's, I had fun with them. But, yeah, so Hanzo, this compound is where we run into Trafficking, who's, like, kind of that boss that taunts you with, like, video screens when you see him, and it's like, he's kind of always watching you. And, again, with his name, I was expecting to get some kind of backstory, like, oh, he's, like, you know, trafficking all these people from da-da-da-da. Or doing some terrible thing, but you don't really get that. I forget. You fight him, right? And then you get his.
He chases you down a hallway, and then you fight him.
You have that weird that fight where you have to shoot all those cylinders and zap him a few times.
Yeah.
Yeah, that wasn't too great either. I guess.
It was a neat concept for sure, but like
it was different. Like I appreciate when things are different, but it wasn't fun in a sense.
Yeah, it was like, oh, cool. I put him in the middle of the square, and then he gets zapped, and then I hit him, and then I do it again. All right, gotcha.
Yeah.
And then he becomes your best friend for a little bit.
Yeah, that was weird. Like you put his head is on like a little robot that follows you around, and then like her hacks him, and you get control over him by shocking him into submission, which is pretty messed up.
Yeah, he's like on a little floating jetpack thing, and like he has to open doors for you, and you have to force him to by shocking him. Which again, if he were a crueler character or something, you could get into. But here, I just feel like a dick. Yeah.
I didn't even think of it. I didn't even think of the narrative ramifications. Like I said earlier, I just kind of thought, okay, and here's another door where I have to hold the A button for 5 seconds before the door opens. Great.
And then he's like going through the hyperspeed things like unguarded while you're just following you behind you the whole time.
And this happens screaming. This happens in the level around the same time you actually get Trafficking as a pet. They start introducing these elements like the hyper travel light bikes, which are like these. they're like on roller coaster rails, basically, and you get on them and you hold A, and ostensibly, like, this little meter fills up, and then a second meter fills up, and then ostensibly you're going at the speed of light. And the first time you do it, that felt really cool, right? Like, I liked that.
And then you do it four more times.
Yeah, and then it's not as cool.
Yeah, exactly. The double meter was great. Like, that second meter comes in, it's like, oh, here we go, and then, you know, like you
said. Yeah. Like, it would make sense if it was, like, a Dark Souls thing where all the areas are connected, and that would make sense from a, I guess, a perspective or scale reasoning, but they just are there.
Yeah.
For no reason.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. Like, if you had a bigger world, this would be a good fast travel-y kind of thing. Or maybe the first couple times an option to skip. But, here it just becomes a weird, repeated set piece.
Mm-hmm. Especially when all the levels sort of, like, obviously, like, making a game's hard and art design is hard, so not to diminish that, but when all the levels look the damn same, like, they're all red, they all have metal floor, they all have ominous things that are, like, sort of cybernetic written on the floor. So when you're going from one set piece to another, and it's like, cool, meet the new boss, same as the old boss, gotcha, that impact is definitely diminished when it starts blending together like that.
Yeah, and especially for a game so short, too, when if any kind of repetition kind of breaks it
totally.
For you.
Totally.
All right, so I'm just seeing the end of this Traffic King section. Mm-hmm. Yep, you just whack him a whole bunch, and then he follows you around, and he's your pet.
Yep.
Let's see here. And then I'm trying to remember who the boss... Well, is that where we meet the Geminis? More or less, the six sisters, who are like the real AI that are controlling Mother...
I think you...
I like their design a lot.
Yeah, they're pretty cool.
I love their design. This is like...
What?
This is like everything. Like, I just like... So, it's like this twin sister AI kind of thing. And it's like really horrific and just really well done.
Yeah, they do have a whole good cop, bad cop kind of relationship where one of them is like really nice to you and the other one wants to kill you constantly. Yeah.
It's like, it's funny because when you mentioned earlier, like maybe a year from now, you won't remember anything about Ruiner. Like I'll remember them because I thought they were a really cool boss character, villain.
And like from a, like a dialogue standpoint too, like there are a lot of games that have these like sibling AIs or robots or twins that you fight. Like, I don't know, even God Hand has a series of twins that you fight, if I remember correctly. But like...
The gay guys.
Yeah. That hasn't aged well. but you... in this, in all of those games, you have this sense of like, oh, I just killed this sibling, now this sibling's sad, and now they're doing another move because they're sad. And I did kind of like that the sisters sort of seem to fucking hate each other. And that was a really fun dynamic, honestly.
Totally.
Yeah.
All right. And then,
if I remember, they control, like, Imagination Farms, right? Because there's...
Yeah.
This sort of, the whole thing behind Hanza, one of the things behind them, I should say, is they take people as hosts and they sort of like feed off their sensations to give like richer people like virtual reality kind of environments with like real sensations. It's sort of like they're draining these hosts to give people better like VR experiences or something like that.
It's like Westworld.
Yeah. I still haven't seen Westworld, but yeah.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
No, that's okay. That's all right. I'll just trust you on that. Yes, it's just like Westworld. But
well, based on how season two turned out, I don't know if you should.
Hey now. Anyway, keep going.
Yeah. So and. If I remember, like, the main plot thread doesn't really do too much with that, if anything, really. Like, who you are and who her is and et cetera.
It's basically there just to explain the
it's
angels.
Window dressing.
It's tropey window dressing, too, in the sense of, like, hey, guys, guess what? It's virtual reality, and virtual reality is actually bad. Isn't that scary?
Yeah. You know what? Like, I could have bought, like, trafficking is the person who is supplying all these poor people to, you know, have their emotions or what have you harnessed to become these, like, husks. for this stuff. Then you say, okay, I'm going to take this piece of shit along with me and shock him to open doors. I'm on board. But without that, it's just like, where, you know, okay, I'm just a dick.
Yeah, I think it does. It doesn't become that dark anyway, because like, it's like, oh, these things are powering VR, unless I'm reading it wrong. But we already have VR that works. It would have made more sense. It was like, they're stealing limbs from orphans and homeless people.
Or they're taking like organs to reset for people so they live forever. You know, there's like
Like those third children.
Like how
kind of
how trafficking exists, because he's basically been alive for like 200 years and just lives off severing arms.
Like even if they had done something with the third children that that Beef mentioned, of like, oh, the third children, like they get drafted in the military service and then they get super experimented on by this guy. It's like that would be a military industrial complex like commentary that you could have slid in there, but it's like, they didn't.
It's like they say when you're writing cyberpunk, hyper exploit your darlings. You know, like make me hate these motherfuckers. Like, you know,
absolutely.
I want to duck and take a Raijin and just wipe them all out. All that.
For record, in case there isn't some kind of big explanation that makes it all worth it, I'll apologize in advance to anyone commenting right now.
That's the thing. I think like Rooner like touches on this stuff, and you're like. You're like, come on, like, you know, commit, like, get in there, you know, what's going on? And it just never quite does. It's just like, I'm going to have sequels or something. Like, they were going to do this. And it's like, what do you, like,
I feel like that's a problem that's endemic of, like, a lot of cyberpunk video games in general of, like, here are all these cool ideas that we're kind of mentioning that maybe kind of have some sort of commentary to them, but we're never going to actually, like, we're waffling. We're not going to make a statement or anything. Everything is window dressing, like you said. And that's a problem with this game, and it's a problem with, like, a lot of games that have to do with science fiction. And I don't know if that's, like, just to make the experience more palatable, if it's, like, laziness. I don't know what it is. But it's certainly, as I played this, I was reminded of other cyberpunk-esque games that left me wanting more. That as a subgenre, there are only a few games, like, Valhalla is one of them, that I really feel go into the world as much as I want them to.
Like, this game feels like it could have been a side story in any other generic cyberpunk universe.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because it follows all the beats of every, you know, just any other universe with exploitation and stuff like that.
Yeah.
I feel like there's, like, thousands of other timelines where someone started to make Rooner, and then they had to give up on it because their scope was too big. And this, like, Raycon Games at least had the wherewithal to say, I don't think we can make quite what we want, but maybe this is at least a step in that direction. And they did release the game. You know what I mean? You could see, like, this game going on for 20 hours and just being a slog because they have to get into, like, some parts of the story that they couldn't, etc. Or just never really being released at all, you know? It's not, like, the optimal way, and I'm not trying to apologize for them either. It's, like, one of those things where if I had to explain why it is the way it is, that's probably the theory I could come up with.
Making games is hard.
Yeah, exactly. But, yeah, so we get out of Hanza compound, and we go to hell, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
The opposite of heaven. And we go to save our brother, which I don't think a whole lot of plot stuff happens, you know, until the very end, right? Where we encounter our brother, who turns it.
Yeah. Oh, I will say, this game, like, 95% of the time works perfectly. There have been situations where my weapons stop working or things don't load properly and I have to, like, kill myself in order to zoom back in. So, there was a bug where it happened, like, I could replicate it. But, if you're doing slow down or instant kill when you're fighting those arms that drop down the angels, you lose control of your weapons, and like it kind of broke me out of it just slightly. I don't know if you guys ran into any issues like that.
I definitely ran into an issue on the final fight where you fight a bunch of those dudes at once, and I was right near the end, and this is a strange glitch. I have a screen cap of it. I need to put it in the chat. Of an enemy spawned above me, and it was walking above me like it was on a floor. And so he kept walking over me and shooting, but he was shooting in a straight line, so he couldn't hit me. And this was at the very end of that giant onslaught of enemies with the timer, and I had to start that over because of this.
I find the fact that, because the final battle is pretty much gauntlet of enemies. And I guess they're calling back the time limit that Wizard gave you, but by then you're so powerful, it's like, I've got, because every time you kill them, like, the buffer goes up. So, like, I had, like, an 8-minute buffer or something ridiculous. Not really, but, you know, like, it was It was just a long fight. It wasn't necessarily.
I think it was more of a victory lap after everything you've accomplished.
Yeah,
I
think
absolutely.
Like I'm jumping back. So then we fight the Traffic King boss. Oh. So they give him huge limbs and turn him into basically one of the heavy cyborg guys.
Yeah, I forgot.
And then you fight him like two or three times.
Mm.
Yep, and it's kind of the same as the last several times you fought heavy cyborgs.
Yep.
Yeah.
Not really much I can say about him.
Yeah, he's just kind of like a, he's kind of a reskin.
Yeah.
Okay, so I got a hypothetical for you. Say that you get to live to 200, except you are turned old and decrepit like him. Would you rather be floating inside a thing you can control with your mind, or limbs. Have limbs?
Limbs.
Really? I wouldn't mind mind control or everything if it's the, you know, the same, if it's the same fake experience, but...
I don't know. If I couldn't, like, feel walking around, that would just be really weird for me.
I mean, I guess...
you don't, you're, so you're saying you don't want to be MODOK?
No, I don't want to be MODOK.
No, I mean, so, as long as you can feel the limbs, too. Because if you're just in a big robot suit kind of thing, that is just like, well, I'm still ahead, and then it's like, you might as well fly at that point. But, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Did they ever establish that Adam Jensen can feel anything in Deus Ex, where, like, he gets his cybernetic limbs, but can he actually feel anything? I was always super unclear on that.
I know from a design perspective, they want you to feel stuff so you know that you don't break them and cost millions of dollars, but I can't recall.
Okay.
Maybe it's like, what is it, how does he put it in Terminator 2? It's like, I registered damage sensations. The feedback could be construed as pain. That was my Arnold Schwarzenegger impression, by the way.
That was that. Hey, God's here. Oh man, speaking of Terminator, there's something I wanted to say. I didn't know where to slip this in.
Fuck you, asshole.
There are these enemies. there are these enemies in the game called Harpies, and they were just fucking Terminators. Like, they just had Terminator skulls on their faces. Like, it looked just like a T-1000, and that really it made me laugh a lot.
Yeah, I think unfortunately a lot of the grunts, they all act the same AI-wise, so you don't really get, but it was cool that they designed like different, every area had different enemies instead of just finding creeps over and over.
Looking at the art for them, I feel like, correct me wrong, it's maybe supposed to try to be, not Tengu, what's that mask, the like Oni kind of mask, maybe I'm...
With the horns, right?
Yeah, like a yokai kind of thing. I can't think of the actual
name,
but... But you're right. It looks very like T-800 or
T-800. That's the right one.
Yeah.
Yep.
But yeah.
Or a snatcher.
Or a snatcher.
Yeah,
I could see that. Yeah.
All right. So when you start running, you go towards the end, towards the Six Sisters, you kind of see all the NPCs again talking to you and like, we're cheering you on. Do your best. And that was kind of weird.
Yeah. That was
Weird.
Like I don't know you guys. Why are you cheering for me?
Yeah.
Okay, so the last fight is basically another mother fight again. Just with zombies.
Except
around
you have cover that you can exploit this time.
Yeah, yeah. And then it just blasts through all zombies for you. So you're just you're actually regenerating health constantly during this fight too.
Yeah, they're called drained hosts. Their art is like it's almost like cyberpunk version of the Silent Hill nurses in a way, and that's like a woman in a tight jumpsuit, and there's like cleavage, and but she's wearing like a big VR helmet that's like connected to her chest and like she's got like
I thought that was cool.
Yeah, these like gory fangs and like their ball. It's like, looking at the art, it's like a really well done like enemy. You know,
Isn't their story too? Like they're basically husks of humans. Like all of their stuff has already been uploaded to virtuality, so they're just kind of like mindless.
Exactly. Yeah. They're cool. Virtuality workers who earn their karma by being a source of entertainment. Trapped and wired inside virtuality pods, their stimuli are transferred to clients as part of those real sensations, virtual worlds. Drained and powerless, these poor souls can be manipulated into anything. They pose no real danger individually, but can be overwhelming in swarms. Threat level infinity, which I think is overstating things a little bit.
Yeah. There were a couple times I died to them, but they weren't too... tough. They were just a different kind of enemy for that area.
Like, yeah, you know.
Yeah, they shove them all in a corridor and they give you a flamethrower and they're like, go to town.
The threat level in the enemies catalog is on a scale of 10, like a little filled bar. Heavy cyborgs are 9 out of 10. Mothers 9 out of 10. But drain hosts, they just have the infinity symbol, which it's like what?
I think it's because they're endless.
Oh, All right.
And I do wonder too, like in the arena mode, if like they really can fuck you up in big numbers. Cause like I hadn't messed around with the arena mode at all that unlocks, but like I do wonder if they're more of a palpable threat there.
Yeah, I tried like 10 minutes of an arena and then I got bored, so I left.
Okay.
But yeah, so you're in hell is the last level, right? Yeah. Which is Imagination Forums, where all these people are getting husked out or what have you. And
you fight the sisters.
Yep. And then I think you meet your brother, right?
Yeah. Yep.
And your brother is somebody else wearing that mask. And it turns out this was all a big plan that your brother is really like the head of, like the CEO of Heaven Corporation. Yeah. You're basically kind of like a clone that he's going to use to harvest organs if he needs them, more or less. Or
yeah.
Maybe...
Yeah, that's true. Right. And he was basically just using you to weed out all the insurgents in the company.
And the mask is basically his way of being able to experience his revenge. Like, I can't really say vicariously, like almost like literally through you. Like, he can see and feel what you're feeling. I did misspeak a little, if I remember, because you're not literally a clone. Like, it's a little unclear what you actually are to him, if you're his real brother, perhaps a third child, and we'll find out more in a sequel, or what have you. But you are genetically similar, either through familial relations or something else.
You're biocompatible, so you can get through all the... That's how you're able to get through all the security things.
That's right.
Yep.
That's right. Yeah.
And, like, so there was an accident. Like, I'm watching this cutscene right now where, like, he lost an arm, so he just took your arm.
Ah. Yeah, so...
Like, as someone who's, like, I was really kind of down on the narrative as a whole, and I still am, I think that this was probably one of the only points in the game where I was genuinely interested in what was happening. Of, like, oh, this is a dude you're just kind of exploiting to take his limbs and make him do your bidding because he matches you genetically. Like, That's an interesting idea, and it's kind of not the plot. Like, I knew there was going to be some twist, like you said earlier. I was waiting for the big reframing device to happen, but mm-hmm. I didn't expect this to be it.
Mm-hmm.
I was expecting, like, the brother to be fake or something the entire time.
Yeah, I
was expecting her was, like, making up something, like, in that one Ghost in the Shell book where, like, Bato is convinced he has a family that he doesn't actually have. I was expecting her to be, like, rewiring your brain like that, and it totally was something radically different, and I liked that, and I like what they do with her, which you can describe a little bit more. I think they do something cool with her character.
Yeah, okay, so we did get one question sent in to us by @ColinWeaver96. That person wrote, what did you think of the reveal of her? And I thought her reveal as basically a cyborg hacker trying to get through the system too was kind of neat. Like,
yeah.
Yeah. She looks really cool in her...
Yeah, her head splits open.
For some reason.
It's like Ghost in the Shell 2 Innocence, where like they have the gynoid's head splitting open. It's like that.
Yeah, but I'm curious, why does she need a Band-Aid then?
Yeah, no. Aesthetic. But no, I really thought the reveal of her was really neat. I was really expecting her to just be some awful monster of a human.
Yeah, I was expecting her to betray me, but in fact, she was helping me the whole time.
Yeah, and I thought that was really neat and nifty, and I kind of like the fact that there's just this sarcastic robot girl AI. I thought that was really a nifty idea. And then she tells you a bunch of, like, big nouns for you to pay attention to, and the game just ends.
What is it? Meet.
But yeah, that was cool.
Meet me at the place where heaven falls, or something like that. I think.
Yeah, that's exactly what she says. You ride off on your motorcycle after you like take out your brother. You get a choice of like, do you hack his, do you fry his brain, or do you bludgeon him? And I bludgeoned him because like, why not?
Yeah, it doesn't seem to really matter.
Yeah, the choices in this game were just like flavor. And you ride off on your motorcycle, and she tells you to meet you where heaven falls, and it's like, cool, game over, you're done, and I guess there's room for a sequel. I guess that's what they're trying to do there.
Yeah.
But her reveal itself was cool.
Yeah, totally. I mean, I don't know how to feel about the whole brother subplot, because I feel like there could have just been a lot out of the mystery of why someone hacked you in the first place, who you were trying to kill, mm-hmm. the boss, etc. So then... I guess just when, even at the start of it, like, okay, now we're going to save your brother, that's where I was starting to, like, kind of side-eye the plot a little. I felt like, I do agree with you that I do like it was things I wasn't expecting, It didn't do any of the tropes I was thinking it was going to. It definitely kept me guessing. Not like a big twist or anything like that, but right. You know, still like, I guess it left me wanting a little more too, you know?
Yeah.
Not necessarily in the good way, but I felt like, again, it just didn't, it was just sort of missing something. I felt like a little plot dumpy at the end. I kind of wish there was some callback sort of thing I could tie together to it. Be like, oh, well, that's why that happened then. But it didn't really feel like that.
It just kind of went forward.
Yeah.
And it didn't have
they were trying to bring like all these NPC companions to like root for you at the end. But I felt like it would have, like we were talking about Nerve, it would have been more impactful if like he took a hit for you or something. Or
yeah.
Yeah. Or like all
I think Beef, like you had a Freudian slip when you described it as the brother subplot, because it does feel like a subplot. It feels like just flavor that it happens to be the main story that I'm supposed to be super invested in.
Yeah.
There's
just like a lot of stuff like that. I mean, like Rustum, the cop who like quit and he's wearing a NASA jacket and ex-police. Anyway, he helps you that one time. Next. You know, like, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
He apparently knew trafficking because I went back to talk to him when you have trafficking along, and they used to be at each other's throats for a long time, and I don't care anymore.
Right.
Yeah, there's... The plot itself feels ancillary to the world, but the world is not fleshed out enough for me to really dive deep into it. And so the game's plot exists in this weird liminal space where it's like the main narrative thread is not hooking me as much as it should. The world is not giving me enough of itself as it should. So I'm just kind of going and I guess it's over now, you know? Mm-hmm. It's like it feels very liminal in that way, I guess.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like, it seems like basically her is sort of using you to bring down heaven entirely by, like, doing most of your brother's plan to take out all these traitors within the company, then ultimately himself, and now there's no leadership. But why? Is it because...
Yeah, but why?
Yeah, is she not happy with the Imagination Farms thing going on? And, like...
Is she, like, an AI they, like, made and, like, fucked over or something?
Right. You know,
we don't know.
Did they like? There's like so many like places they could have gone with it. Like, the AI, did they force her to do like the Imagination Farms thing and like fuck over all these poor humans? And then, you know, her revenge now is to destroy the company and kill all.
Like, it felt like the game ended maybe like 10 minutes too early, where they could have had another zone where you get the plot reveals as you're walking that your brother was behind it.
Yeah.
And then you're going through Heaven headquarters where everything looks like nice and clean, like not like this piece of shit. Cyberpunk.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm saying piece of shit in a prison to not, I don't know what the word, I'm saying in a good way.
Yeah. Not like piece of shit, like, ah, oh, this looks like crap, but more like that, everything is like rusted, decayed, kind of like hyper metropolis kind of thing.
Yeah. Because we see this world from the perspective of basically everyone that's the lowest of the class. We don't see it from everyone that get all the rich people that get to experience everything cool. Like, it would have been like cathartic if you got to, you know, blast through.
Yeah.
Like that whole like Star Wars Last Jedi thing where you're blasting through the casino zone.
Yeah. Like, and you know, I think you're touching on something that I think is something this game actually does well, in that most cyberpunk video games in particular, I feel like a lot of them, especially Deus Ex, which I keep harping on, you're sort of like, you're almost always like this privileged white dude, and you're kind of just like looking at everything from your privilege to maybe middle class perspective, I guess. And I think Ruiner does a really good job of showing you like you're just kind of a cog in the machine in a way that other cyberpunk video games don't allow you to be. And I think that's cool.
Mm-hmm. And I guess we'll see a little bit more of that in Cyberpunk 2099 or 6? I forgot what that was.
77.
What if the Cyberpunk game?
69. Yeah. I hope it's 6099. That'd be great.
Okay, so any other thoughts before we wrap this up, I guess? We were a little bit down on it, and I apologize if the developers happen to listen at some point, but we're just being...
It's not that, yeah. I mean, I still give it a 4 out of 5. I think this thing is... I guess maybe I'm one of those people. It was slick enough that I forgive any flaw with, not any, but like a lot of the flaws with it, where I'm still like, this is a great experience. I would definitely play Raycon's next game. Anything in the Ruiner universe I'm interested in. DLC, sequels, you name it, I'm good with it, you know? I just kind of wished, there's just more I wished for going on, you know?
It's a very much like Watch Dogs 1, Saints Row 1 situation of I can tell there are a lot of good ideas here, and I kept wanting them to rear their head in a way they never did. However, I was so hooked by the potential of the ideas that I think if they were given a chance to do a sequel and make a bigger sequel and make a more varied sequel, I think it could be something really great.
Oh yeah, Runer 2 on Kickstarter, I mean, I would fund like crazy.
Tuner,
yes. Yes. No.
They better name it that, honestly.
No, they better not, honestly.
No. Oh man. But yeah, I know 2.5, 3-ish out of 5 for me, but like a very generous one of those, and that I see what they were trying to do, and I admire that, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Totally.
I'm watching my my speedrun footage now, and you go through it so fast once you know what you're doing.
I should give that a shot, honestly. Like, I haven't messed around with any of that.
Jeez. Yeah, the world record's 40 minutes something, so they last, like, that. I was expecting the game to be that long at the start. It's kind of refreshing that they made this whole thing out of it. I think from a presentation perspective, like S+ rank is just like narratively and maybe sometimes the gameplay a little bit below that.
Yeah, there's a lot of style and there's like a little bit of substance and then there's like questionable narrative substance, you know?
It's like
tenuous.
Yeah, I feel like 14-year-old me would have been like, this is a 11 out of 10 game. Nothing, yes. You know what I mean? If you'd caught me just like a little earlier in my life, I would have been like, this is the greatest thing ever. Like, it's so...
Yeah, I absolutely agree with that. Like, I think if I were a kid, if I were a teen, it would have blown me away. But now it's kind of like, I want a little more. And I hope we get it. I genuinely hope they get to make more.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So yeah, make more. That'd be cool.
Absolutely.
All right, so Bello, what are you up to? And where can we find you if we want to find you?
I am... at The Fried Critic on Twitter. I post on my blog that's also called The Fried Critic, and I have a podcast that's about anime called Braketto Punchy, and we make new episodes sometimes, so you should give us a listen.
All right, and Beefy, where can we find you?
Slobby is a pretty good handle for me on Twitter, Twitch, YouTube, all that jazz, you know? I'm a big Bullet Hell guy, but I like to play pretty much like anything obscure and weird, and I also do the Hardcore Gaming 101 podcast lately. That's fun.
Yeah, and I guess this will come out in like September or August, but you just start re-uploading Red Spray stuff, like a new one's out from Monday for now?
This Monday we're going to start Overblood 2, which went from a survival horror game to a Final Fantasy VII ripoff.
Really? let me look this up.
What?
You're not going to find much. The fact I'm using quit in the middle of the second mission, it's like, sorry guys, I got stuck.
What's with this protagonist's haircut?
Oh, you should see the rest. but yeah, so we're doing that next. That's on the Retsu Prey channel.
All right. Speaking of shoot 'em up, top-down shooters, or I guess shmups, I'm really glad you like Geppi so much.
I love Geppi X. I was so happy I found that accidentally. But because I mean, I knew other people knew about it, but I had no idea. And then just running into it was like, what is this? Geppi X is so good. But.
And then you think you get tired of this theme music going on constantly, but it really,
you can't.
Yeah, it really grows on you. Okay, people listening, you can find me on my YouTube channel, which you're probably watching this on, or on the podcast, which you can find on iTunes, whatever. I've been doing a lot of video editing work lately for different friends, including Matt McMuscles, so you can follow me there. Otherwise, Twitter is at Trongasm, TRUONGASM. So that's it. Thanks for listening, and you caught me on a good end.
Yeah.